Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm Stuart Dambrot, your host. Today we have the honor of having as a guest Mark Wigley, architectural theorist, scholar, and author, as well as the dean at the Columbia Graduate School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation. Welcome, and thank you so much for coming.
Nice to be here.
There's a lot to be said and a lot to be discussed. I thought we perhaps could do a quick primer, if you will, a quick introduction to architectural theory for those who don't know the differentiation from architecture as such.
Well, actually, every architect's a theorist. People tend to think that architect is somebody who designs a building,
right,
makes a building, but actually, architects don't make buildings, they make ideas about buildings. It doesn't actually matter if the building gets built, because what the architect is a kind of philosopher of what a building might mean. In the same way, I don't know, you could read the newspaper or you could read a poem. And they're both made out of words, but the poem is also aware of itself and is thinking. A piece of architecture is, it's a building, but it's thinking about what it means to be a building. So the architect is somebody who thinks about the way that buildings think. And for an architect, yeah, buildings talk to us. They speak to us about our dreams and our aspirations. So when you talk to an architect, you're not really talking about buildings so much, you're talking about dreams.
Well, that is interesting. And it makes the first thing it actually makes me think of, and it's very far afield. But when I'm involved in the usual area of my discussions when someone's talking about string theory,
right,
I always describe it as a mathematical poem,
right,
because there's no way to check out its physical conformance,
right,
with reality.
Right.
And that is, it's almost a philosophy of physical reality in a way.
Yeah.
Right? And it's very interesting.
Yeah. I mean, when we think about buildings in our society, buildings are meant to be very stable. Actually, even the word stability, we think of buildings. We think of something that's stable as having solid foundations.
And it's, ah, quite right.
You see, it's, yeah, buildings that have foundations. Or if we think somebody's making a good argument, we say that's a strong argument or a stable argument. Or what's the basis for what you're saying? In other words, we use buildings as our image of sort of structural stability.
Ah, quite right. Building a company, for example, the same metaphor
right,
is used.
Right. And well, you can be the architect of a nation. So when I say that architects think about buildings and think about what buildings might say to us, that the language with which the building is communicating is the language of structure. So another way to say that is that architects make kind of poems about structure, or they think about what structure is. And what an architect thinks a building might be saying might not be the same as what the people who live in the building think it might be saying. So it's really a dialogue.
This is very interesting, because it also, if we, I mean, well, what occurs to me using the poetic metaphor,
yeah,
there are different forms of poetry. There's everything from haiku to poesy, prose poems,
right,
and that would seem to map very conveniently or even with fidelity to the various types of buildings that can be constructed based on that conversation.
Yeah, and you could say that architecture is also a certain kind of poetry in the sense that architects are optimists, you know, they're genetically optimists, despite despite all the evidence. And every architect thinks that a small change in the built environment, a very small change, will make you hesitate in your daily life. And if you hesitate, then you will see your world. If you don't hesitate, if you just live your life, you won't see the world you live in. In other words, for example, we don't, as we live in cities, we don't see those cities in the same way that fish doesn't see water. It's just the environment. Now, the architect changes the built environment in such a way that you see it. You actually see your environment. And because you see it, you start thinking. And if you think a little, maybe you dream a little. And if you dream a little, maybe if we all dream a little bit, we would live in a different society. So the architect thinks that very small changes to the built environment trigger a kind of chain reaction of thought and aspiration by which we might live in a better society. So architects really think of themselves as kind of social engineers using very small objects to trigger very large changes in dreams.
It almost sounds like a sociological interpretation of chaos theory, right? Small change, big effect.
Yeah, I mean, firstly, architecture is a virus. I mean, if you if you fall in love with buildings and you become an architect, there's no cure, and it's highly contagious, by the way. So you should keep your distance.
I'm afraid it's too late already.
So what happens is the architect falls in love with the thought that buildings are thoughts, and that those thoughts are contagious, and that they're also positive thoughts. In other words, architects see these ideas captured in buildings as actually triggering a kind of deepening of social aspiration. So an architect is not somebody that gives somebody a building. Architect always gives you more than you ask for. So if you ask an architect for a building, you get back not just a building, but a set of dreams. And that those dreams are represented in the building, and the building, as it were, communicates. So for the architect, an architectural object is a sort of broadcast device. It's a medium. But the drawing about the building is another, or the lecture about a building, or the description of the building, or the photograph of the building. In other words, the building itself is even just the beginning of a much wider discourse. And of course, imagine now that we have a street with a number of different buildings in it done by different architects, each of those buildings is communicating an idea.
Right.
Now they start to talk to each other.
In various dialects, as it were.
Right. So the city becomes a multi-dimensional discussion about our own future. So when we live in a city, we don't just live in a place. We live, and it's not just a place that's fixed, and we are the changeable elements. Like, it's not just, there's the city, for example, New York City, 200 languages being spoken on the street. The city itself has many languages. And so a city is an extraordinarily complex, multi-dimensional, parallel processing machine. And of course, the buildings are still there even when we are not. When we die, for example, our buildings keep talking for us and about us. So in a certain sense, almost the least, you know, the least loud part of a city are the people who live in it. The city itself is the real talker.
While you were explaining that, it occurred to me that the instantiation of the environment you were talking about, if you look at, say, smaller towns or cities or villages in, so let's say Europe or parts of Europe, where there is relatively uniform architecture, and they have a very, they have a more monocultural environment, monolinguistic environment, and they tend to extend in time without change for a longer period. Where something like New York, all I can think of is, say, the Cooper Union Building, which is a dramatic statement and does force one to think and react. And I can see how various types of innovation in construction would definitely spark a lot of interest and dialogue.
Yeah, well, a city is a biological organism, right? It's not like it's a made of stone and metal and glass, and it's fixed and stable, and then there is this life form within it, like the human species. Well, firstly, there are many more species in a city than...
Oh, there certainly are.
Than, in fact, cities are just as biodiverse as what we think of as nature. In fact, what we think of as nature today is increasingly less biodiverse, and cities are increasingly biodiverse, more and more species in cities. But the city itself is a biological organism. It grows, it breathes, it breeds. You could argue that a European city that is relatively stable over time, has a kind of monoculture, as you say, is actually a dead city.
Quite right, because species will expand.
Yeah.
And that's fair. And if there's limits to expansive physical growth, it gets more complex internally.
New York is, of course, the very paradigm of cosmopolitan density, right? Sort of scale, speed, density, complexity, immigrant city, so people changing direction, many languages, many thoughts, a lot of mobility, emotional mobility, personal mobility, economic mobility. The world is increasingly more like New York and increasingly less like a European city, as you described. And more than that, New York is old technology. New York is to the world today maybe like our parents. It's like a incredibly honorable example of the way things used to be done. Right. So a couple of hundred years ago, New York was a model of cosmopolitan density, of the vibrancy, the kind of ecological density. Now probably it's Mumbai, 200 years later. And it's quite possible, in what is arguably the single biggest experiment in human history, 7 billion people will be living in cities by 2050, and that'll be 70% of the world's population. Now, nobody knows what this means. Nobody. Nobody has any sense of what this means. But if I want a clue as to what's going on there, I would look to New York, and then I would look to Mumbai, and then I'd look to Sao Paulo, Rio, and so on. And I wouldn't look to a stable European city. Interestingly, I wouldn't look to an American city either. So perhaps in the next 50 or so years, cities will go through the biggest transformation that we've ever seen. And Western Europe and America will play no part in the future of cities, no part at all. They will be dignified spectators.
That sounds, it makes eminent sense. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much.